morning, here we are to do the last session on gifts of the Holy Spirit, or gifts of the Spirit.
Woo!
God, yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. How's everybody today?
Amen.
Yes, that was a little weak, but I heard two claps.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, there's another one.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's go to Joel chapter 2. This is the days we're living in, the prophecy of Joel chapter 2 that's spoken by Peter when 3,000 souls came into the church on the day of
Woo! Hallelujah.
We're going to quote the scripture that Peter quoted in the most powerful sermon ever preached on planet Earth.
Amen.
Prophecy of Joel chapter 2. Let's look at that this morning. Joel chapter 2 verse 28. God's Spirit is going to be poured out on all flesh. Amen?
Amen.
We are living in a time right now. We are living in the days of the fulfillment of Joel chapter 2, verse 28 through 30. We have been living in those days, but you and I are particularly blessed to live in the end of days.
Right.
End of times. And these scriptures are being fulfilled as we speak.
That's right. Yeah.
In this church this morning, this scripture is being fulfilled. That's exciting. You've heard this before, but let's read it. Joel chapter 2, verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward, in the end.
Right.
This was prophesied 4,000 years ago.
That's right.
Afterward, in the end days, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh.
Amen. Come on.
And your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Did you parents get that one? Your sons and your daughters will prophesy.
That's
Say
right.
that with me. My sons.
My sons. My daughters will prophesy. Amen.
Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Your old men shall dream dreams. I guess I qualify for that. Glory. Hallelujah. And your young men shall see visions.
Come on.
Do you men receive that?
Come on.
Amen.
Do you see visions? Ask the Lord. Ask the Lord to show you visions. I dream dreams. I ask God to give me prophetic dreams, and He does.
Amen.
We ever had one this morning. It was awesome.
Amen.
It was just awesome. I don't have time to go into it because He has these complex, long dreams. In verse 29, and also it even gets better. On my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my Spirit in those days. That means down to the servants in the house.
Right.
In the days of Israel,
right.
The house servants, the Spirit of prophecy will be poured out. Down to the little girl serving the pitcher of water.
Sure, amen.
Everybody was prophesying. Just like when Saul went up to the mountains to go after David, and he came to a high place, and he came among the school of the prophets, and they were all prophesying. And then Saul started prophesying. And
Come on.
Instead of killing David, he started prophesying before the Lord, and he laid on his back all night under the stars prophesying.
That's right.
He woke up and said, there's no sense trying to kill him. He went home. Everybody that tried to come after David started prophesying. The Spirit of prophecy is alive in the church today. I want to tell you, the Spirit of prophecy did not go away with the apostles. Because there's two teachings in the church. You'll go to a lot of places and they'll say, that went away with Paul and the apostles.
No.
I'm telling you, that is incorrect.
That's right.
The Spirit of prophecy and the gifts of the Spirit are alive and well in the church today. And the Holy Spirit is alive and well in His people. And it did not pass away, but it's alive and well in Crossroads Chapel today.
Come on, amen.
And everyone listening to this teaching, the spiritual gifts are alive and well today.
That's right.
There are still apostles. You remember this one?
Yeah.
Or apostles, excuse me. Apostles, you can do it with me. Prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the building up of the body of Christ, for the edifying, for the building up of the body of Christ, to encourage you today. Some are in this building that are some of those ministry gifts. You remember the motivational gifts? There were seven of those. This is going to stand you. There's something like 30 gifts. And then there's more than that, but there's 30 basic gifts. And this is what God has poured out in the church. When Jesus ascended on high, he led captivity captive. He opened up paradise, and he led it with him up to where he's at in the sides of the north, wherever that is. That's way up there somewhere. That's where Jesus is. That's where I'm going to be. That's where you're going to be.
Amen.
Come
and he
on.
Gave gifts to men. And as he left, he threw out silver coins to the church.
Right.
And he said, receive this one, apostle. Receive this one, prophet. Receive this one, evangelist. Church, receive this one. And they're still alive and well in the church, and they're in this building
today. Amen.
Some of you have not discovered, you know, what God's called you to be. But I want to stir up your pure minds by way of the scriptures last week. There are seven motivational gifts. Amen. You remember those ones we looked at last week? What were those? Some of you good note takers out there. Amen. That was Romans chapter 12. Seven motivational gifts. Does somebody have those? All you good students.
Anna does.
There's a prophet. Are there prophets in the house?
Amen.
You're motivated prophetically. You might not stand in the fivefold ministry of a prophet, but are there prophets still in the house? Yes, and all God's people should prophesy. Because what did we just read out of Joel? Upon all flesh I will pour out my spirit. What does that mean? That means all flesh can prophesy.
Right.
Was Saul one of the prophets when he came up to go after David and he started prophesying? No, but the spirit of prophecy came upon him. It can come upon anyone in this, anybody in this building today can prophesy.
Amen.
You might look at me and think, well, I don't know how to do that. God says, open your mouth and I'll fill it. God could give you a word, young lady sitting right back there, and you can speak it out today, and it could be just as much from God as what I'm telling you today.
Amen.
It could be just as much from God. We're going to prophesy through the music today.
Amen.
The spirit of prophecy is alive. I can feel the electricity in the air in this building.
Come on.
Because the spirit of prophecy is alive. This makes your hair just stand up right up on end. I'm telling you, God's in this building today.
That's right.
Because we're two or three are gathered. Amen. It's not about the number, and there's more than two or three here. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Are there ministers in the house? That means servants. Yes, all of us. We're all motivated to serve in the house of God. Are there teachers in the house? Oh, I asked this last week and y'all got quiet. I mean, there's one right there. There's one right there.
Come on.
There's probably another one right there. I bet you there's four or five teachers sitting right in this room right now that
Amen.
Are motivated, motivationally teachers. You might not be in the fivefold office of a teacher, but you're motivated to teach. Matter of fact, an elder, you know what the definition of an elder is? One who is apt to teach and patient. So
right.
Somebody that rules in the church should always be able to teach the Word of God.
Right.
You don't have to be fivefold called into ministry like Kenneth Copeland is a teacher to the body of Christ. That's a fivefold calling, a ministry gift to teaching. But anyone in this church can be motivated from God to break down the Word for another person and disciple someone. That's teaching. That's motivation to teach. Are there exhorters, encouragers in the house? We need encouragement.
Amen.
We need a lot of encouragement.
Right.
The main tool the devil uses is discouragement. What's God going to use? Encouragement. He's going to use the opposite tool.
That's exactly
Satan's
right.
Satan's always going to counter what God... And God's always trying to encourage you, my friend. Always. God doesn't want you to be down. He wants you to be up on top of it all the time.
Amen.
There are givers in the church. Amen. Where's the givers out here? Come on, don't get quiet on that one. There are givers in the church. People are motivated to give. Motivated to earn and give. Amen. We're going to be doing some giving this morning. There's leadership in the church. People that are just born to lead. There's mercy gifts in the church. Oh my God, have mercy. There's so much judgment in the world. There's so much judgment in the church. We need the mercy gift. We need to be very forgiving. We need to have a heart for people. We need to love people. We need to treat people the way the Lord would treat people. And those are the seven motivations from God. And then there are nine manifestations of the Holy Spirit. So when you get filled with the Holy Ghost, not only is there five ministry gifts that can come out of that from your calling, when you receive Jesus as Lord, Romans 10, 9 and 10, if I confess with my mouth Jesus is Lord,
that's right.
I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, right. I shall be saved.
Amen.
Are you in this room today that got that one?
That's right.
If you are saved and the Spirit of Jesus lives in you, everything I've just said to you could happen to you. Probably will. Of those seven motivations, you have one main one, maybe a secondary one, maybe a third and fourth. There's no set rule, but typically there's a strong one and a secondary. Did some of you identify yourself last week? I see one, she got identified. See, this, she's going to be powerful in the kingdom when you start to know who you are.
Right.
You quit listening to people tell you who you are.
That's right.
God tells you who you are. You are powerful in the kingdom.
That's right.
You're unstoppable. If you don't know who you are, you're just kind of...
Amen. That's right.
You know... Like Paul said, beating against the air. You don't know what you're fighting. But when you begin to know who you are, rise up and step up into who you are.
Amen.
Power.
What you were created to do
That's right.
on this planet. Then every day is not futility. Every day has meaning and purpose because everything you do supports that gift because God put that gift in you. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was just going to share. I was sharing with somebody last night about that. That, you know, we really don't have an understanding. Some of us do to a certain degree. But I mean...
Mm-hmm.
You know, I pray for that spiritual vision that
Elijah had that when he saw the host, that of the power that is available to us. I mean, either we believe it or we don't. Mm-hmm. Either we access it or we don't. You can have the greatest set of tools and all the stuff, but if you don't apply them, if you don't pick them up and use them, they're meaningless. They're worthless. They'll rust. But with the gifts that God has given us, and they are many, and there's power that is available to us, and the fuel that drives that is the faith by which we walk. And we walk by faith and not by sight. And we have to understand the power. And I've really just, you know, started to really grasp and understand that where I go, the kingdom of God is there. Amen. And I believe that. And if you don't, see, that's, we don't, you know, Pastor Scott talks a lot about, you know, we don't, you know, the church always said, you know, or a lot of people in the church say, you know, if we operated in the gifts, or if we lived the way that we're supposed to. I mean, I just understand now more than I did before, and that's good. That's a good thing. I'm learning more about how powerful we are and what we can do in the Spirit. And it's not the, you know, I know who Paul preaches, you know, but you know what I'm saying? I mean, because sometimes we try to act in, well, I'm preaching the Jesus that Paul spoke of. You know what I mean? It's we have the power within each one of us. And the closer that we get to the Lord, the stronger that power is going to be. And we have to take back the ground. Amen. And we have the ability to do that.
We have the ability to take that to the world. First to the body of Christ, so that we can all do what we're supposed to do. But then to the world. That's the whole purpose, to be equipped. But we got to build up the body of Christ. We can't forget that. We got to train and equip them. That's what's happening this morning. And it's just like a light bulb. Okay, the gift of the Holy Spirit is like a light bulb. Somebody gives you a light bulb, right? You plug it into the socket. The light switches off at that point. But when you flip the light on, the gift of the Holy Spirit is one gift. It's one Holy Spirit, right? It's not nine Holy Spirits.
That's right.
But when you flip the light switch on, nine manifestations can happen from that light switch coming on.
Right.
Nine. We're going to talk about that in just a second. Nine manifestations of the Holy Spirit. What is a manifestation? Something that's from an inward source becomes outward and seen and heard and felt and tasted and touched by people. Even to the five senses, even smelled and tasted and touched. The Lord said, come taste and see that I'm good. He's talking about the gifts of the Spirit. It should be tangible. The manifestation of the Spirit are these. So don't get, God is not schizophrenic, nine personalities. It's one Holy Spirit, one fruit of the Spirit with nine flavors. I'm going to talk about that too.
Right.
Yes, sir.
I was just going to say, I misspoke. What I meant to say, I think it was the demon, wasn't it, that said, I know the Jesus that Paul preaches of, but the one that you speak of, I don't know.
Amen.
And that's what we have to make sure that we don't do.
Not secondhand knowledge, it's firsthand knowledge.
Exactly. And it's you can't do it through your pastor or through your praise and worship leader. It's on us. The onus is on us, and we got to step up to the plate and do what's called. We are the generation of seekers.
We have a personal Holy Spirit. Amen. Personal Holy Spirit.
That's right.
He lives in each one of us. That's why Jesus said this verse. It's so misunderstood. These things that I do, you will do, and greater things you will do because I go to my Father. Why did he say that? Did he say you're going to come up with new miracles that Jesus never did?
No.
He said greater in quantity.
Right.
Why is that? Because in this room, 20, 30 people, there's 20 or 30 people with 20 or 30 different gift sets from the Holy Spirit, 20 or 30 different anointings of the Holy Spirit. What? That's greater. If just Jesus was here, he would have everything in him, and that is the greatest thing in the world. But what about all you? What about 100 people? What about 1 million people? What about all the Christians in the world?
It's the tools that we have
available
to us now that they didn't have then. I mean, they had to walk to Jerusalem and Jericho. We can send an email and hit 500 people with a click of a button. And that's a greater thing. The ability to prophesy and speak over people and share the word of God is much easier today than it was back then, to be sure.
I know the pastor's going to appreciate this one because you can't leave out the fruit of the Spirit. We're going to go to 1 Corinthians 12. So if you want to get ready to go to 1 Corinthians 12, the nine manifestations of the Holy Spirit. We'll have time to go through those nine if I don't take too long in this part. But all Christians are fruit-bearing. And there's one fruit of the Spirit that's in Galatians 5:22. What are the fruits of the Spirit? Just look at that really quick before we go to 1 Corinthians 12. See, all Christians are to have character. These fruit of the Spirit, I'm going to say fruit singular. You notice it's not fruits. Fruit of the Spirit, nine flavors, if you want to want to look at it that way. It's like an ice cream cone with
Amen.
Flavors. Fruit of Spirit. Fruit of Holy Spirit. It's not even the Holy Spirit. Fruit of Holy Spirit is personal. Fruit of Holy Spirit. In the original translation, the is not in there. It just was put in for reading ability. The original translation said, fruit of Holy Spirit. A lot of you go, well, that doesn't make any difference. It makes a big difference.
It does.
He's not an it or a thing or a power or some kind of force. He is personal. He is Holy Spirit. Amen?
Right.
He is the third person of the Godhead. He is Holy Spirit. He lives in each one of you. When you become born again, he resides in you. When you become filled overflowing, any of these things can come out of you. That's manifestation. That's what we're talking about. The church is really underestimating manifestation, but that's really great. The Corinthian church had manifestations. Paul had to do a lot of correcting to the Corinthian church. Why? Because they forgot one basic thing that Jesus taught in John 15. Fruit. Fruit bearing. He said, without me, you can do nothing. So fruit is character. Look at fruit as character. You have to have character to operate in the gift of prophecy. Or you'll be doing it for yourself, right? Or to evangelize. Character is required for these gifts to manifest in maturity where they don't hurt someone, but they help someone. You can take the power gifts of the Spirit and actually hurt somebody, probably unintentionally, because you think it's all about you. You're not mature. You don't have character. How many ministers have fallen because they had a great gift, but they didn't have character?
So right. That's exactly right.
So let's look at character real quick before we go to 1 Corinthians 12. Yeah. Fruit of the Spirit. Yes.
I see the fruit and the gifts kind of like a house. Mm-hmm. The gifts are like the house and the fruit's like the foundation.
Amen.
If I look at a house and I think, oh, I want that. That's beautiful. It's a wonderful presentation.
Yeah.
If you get an inspection and they come back and say the foundation's not safe, then the house doesn't stand.
It doesn't stand.
So the fruit is the foundation and the gifts is the building.
Because your character is the foundation of who you are. I could have the greatest gift of prophecy on me. I could just read your mail, buddy. I could read your mail, tell you everything. And God, because reading your mail, just God gives you little snippets of information about somebody that you couldn't have known naturally. You could not have known that God said, Shelly, you da-da-da-da-da, fill in the blank. But if I'm prideful, I can take that and go, boy, that was good, wasn't it? And there's no character there to support that gift.
Right.
Next thing you know, I go in presumption, go run off somewhere, act crazy. And that happened to so many ministers because they forgot about the foundational fruit of the Spirit. What are the fruits? Love, joy, peace,
long suffering.
Brotherly kindness, gentleness, goodness,
meekness.
Yes,
self-control.
Faithfulness and self-control. See, without these things, you can just have all mind manifestations going. Without these things, God really can't get done what he wants to get done. So we didn't want to just blow through this and say, let's go to the power of this and let's have all the power.
Right.
You know, it's like John, the two sons that came to Jesus said, Lord, shall we bring down fire upon him? Jesus said, you don't know what spirit you're up, brother. Just slow down for a minute. They were all into the power. You know, said, God, shall we call down a lion out of the wilderness to eat him up? Jesus said, whoa, slow down a minute here. It's about character. That's not in God's character.
Order.
Now, it did happen in the Old Testament. It was in his character at times, but you don't want to get overly zealous with that.
Right.
Amen. All Christians are fruit-bearing, according to John 15, because if you bear fruit, you're going to glorify the Father. That's what Jesus said. Amen. How many are in here to glorify the Father?
Right.
So it's not just about power. Character is the fruit. Charisma is the gift. Think about the two C's. Character is the power. The foundational power. Charisma is the gift. And a lot of people are into charisma with no maturity. And that destroys. It does more destruction than good. So I said that one for Pastor Scott because I know that as a pastor, he would want you to move in power, but he would want you to move with a foundation. Right? But everything we've said is based on that. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 12. It's very powerful. There are nine of those, and I have whole bunch of notes here, so we'll see how far we get. And remember, these are, what did I say these were? Manifestations of the Spirit. If Jesus is in you, any of these things can happen.
Manifestations?
Manifestations. manifestations of the Holy Spirit.
I like that. It's not bad.
So if you look at, what were they? 5 ministry gifts, 7 motivational gifts, there's 12, 9 fruit of the Spirit. You mathematicians, 9 and 12, 21. And 9 manifestations, that's 30. That's just in a brief sense, sir. There's 30 different things that can come out of you. 30. Not just 5, not just 7, 30.
Come on.
God's wanting to multiply in you. Wow, can you just, that just boggles the mind. I started looking at that last night and come up with 30. That didn't even cover them all. There's more things in the Bible about gifting. When Jesus said he gave gifts to men, he wasn't messing around. He led captivity captive, and he
right.
flung out prizes for his warriors. That's you. Are you a warrior today?
Amen.
Take these gifts and use them for God. The first one in 1 Corinthians 12. What's the first verse on that? Let's see. All you iPhone users there. Let's
just
start with the first verse. Yeah, start with the first verse there. 1 Corinthians 12:1.
Now about the spiritual gifts, this is the Amplified, it says the special endowments of supernatural energy.
Ooh.
Brethren, I do not want you to be misinformed.
Ooh. Read that one more time. Read it loud. I want everybody to hear that.
Now about the spiritual gifts, the special endowments of supernatural energy. Brethren, I do not want you to be misinformed.
And it says in my Bible, you're ignorant. God does not
right.
want us to be ignorant of, because my people perish for lack of knowledge. God doesn't want us to be ignorant about these things, okay? Now I want to read on down. Verse 2, for you know that you were Gentiles carried away by these dumb idols. However you were led. I was there at one time. Dumb idols.
Right.
Alcohol.
Right.
Drugs. Dumb idols.
Right.
Dumb idols.
Right.
Oh, I said, how dumb.
Right.
How about a waste of my life?
Right.
Thank God. Therefore, verse 3, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Can you say Jesus is Lord in this room today?
Amen. Amen.
Jesus is Lord. If you can't say that, Antichrist is on.
That's right.
That's the test right there. But if you can say Jesus is Lord, you can only say that by the Holy Spirit. It comes by revelation of the Holy Spirit. That means he has to be in you for you to say Jesus is the Lord.
Jesus is
the Lord. A devil cannot say Jesus is the Lord. He will not say it until the final day where God makes him bow down and confess that Jesus is Lord. Because it says every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess. Until that day, the demons will not confess it until they get cast out of somebody. And then they just have to go where Jesus tells them to go. Whew. Wow. Verse 4. There are diversities of gifts, but one Spirit. The same Spirit. Diversity. 9. We're going to talk about 9. There are differences in ministries, but one Lord. The same Lord. Amen. Wow. Verse 6. And there are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation, I love that word, manifest. I want you to remember that word today, manifestation of the Spirit, is given to each of us for the profit of all. Amen? In this room today, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one of us for the profit of all of us, so that we can all be edified in the church. Wow. Verse 8, for to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. To another, the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. Take note, those two work together. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge. Verse 9. To another, faith by the same Spirit. Faith beyond saving faith. I'm talking about supernatural faith, the gift of faith. To
right.
another, gifts of healings, plural. You notice that word, plural? Oh, we're going to go on that one.
Come on.
The same Spirit, healings, healings. Some people are gifted especially to heal cancer. I don't know why that is, but God supernaturally gifts certain people, and they have specialties. They're like doctors that
right.
specialize in back surgery.
Right.
There are certain Christians I know that if you got a cancer, they're experts at praying against that cancer. They somehow have a revelation. There are others that are more experts. There was one guy, George Mueller, that prayed in lots of money for orphans, lived in his town of coal miners. They were all dying of black lung disease. He prayed healing over so many hundreds and hundreds of these miners. But he's so identified with God at the end, he was taken out by the very disease that he prayed for him to heal him. And I can't explain that before God. Is that God allowed him to so identify with those poor, that poor mining community, that though he was given specifically an anointing to heal black lung disease, at the very end, God took him out by black lung disease. That's just amazing how God...
Think about that. If we all were walking in the office of which we were called, the diseases, the all the different things that we could possibly do. Mm-hmm. I mean, and because I look at all the opportunities that God had placed in my path,
yes,
before I was saved, that were intended for me to operate in the gift, but mm-hmm, I didn't. Mm-hmm. And what chain of events occurred as a result of my disobedience,
right,
not having been where I was supposed to be. And another thing I want to point out with the fruits, what the Bible tells us is that we should all have fruit, yes, but that it should remain. And so oftentimes you'll see an individual that may bear a fruit or have a fruit, but then it disappears. We're supposed to have fruit, and it's supposed to remain.
Amen.
That fruit is supposed to be constant.
Amen. And God is the master gardener, and he prunes, and he takes care of that. Amen. Glory. Yes, sir, brother.
On the, where in verse 7, where it says the manifestation of the Spirit.
Yes.
And what we need to realize is manifestations come out of who we are, not what we do.
Amen.
If the Holy Spirit, if we're full of the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit begins to give a message to us, it manifests. It does not come out of something. It comes out of who I am in Christ, mm-hmm, and in the Holy Spirit empowering me to be able to do that and me yielding to that.
Amen.
But not me doing that.
No.
Okay, so it's like we should be able to ooze the gifts.
You know, that's a good way to say it.
It should be oozing out of us,
yes,
like the shadow of Peter just,
amen,
passing over people.
Amen.
But it was oozing out of him.
Yes.
Not what you do, but who you are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It comes out of who you are.
Right.
It comes out of relationships. So yes, you don't just sit here and go, I think I'm gonna have a healing. You know.
Right.
You don't work it up, and it doesn't come out of soulish power, it comes out of spirit power.
Right. It's there.
And it's
there.
The natural manifestation of the Holy Spirit. We're going to overflow out of praise and worship this morning. There's going to be natural things that are just,
right,
going to go out from us this morning that we're not even aware of, but it should just naturally come out of who we're called to be. Amen. I naturally evangelize because I'm so wired to do that it's just second nature to me to,
right,
evangelize people. And
right,
to disciple people. And I just want to see people grow.
That's,
I just,
right,
want to see people, yeah, come to the next level. I just get tired of seeing God's people beat down, destroyed,
right, right,
lose all their money, lose,
right,
their marriage.
Right.
I get so tired of that. I'm so motivated to see people grow.
That's right.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why God just so energized me to teach.
Amen.
Pull you alongside, encourage you.
Right.
Oh, God just pulls those gifts out of me.
Right.
And I can't help it. The love of Christ constrains me to tell you, brothers and sisters. God loves you. I love you. I want to see you grow.
Amen.
I want to see you do what I do. I want to duplicate Jesus in you. I want to disciple people. I want to see the kingdom of God built,
amen,
in this church.
Amen.
Amen. Not just going to Sunday service. I want to see the kingdom of God manifested. There's that word again. Manifested through who we are, Brother Johnny. That's good. Through who we are. There's gifts of healing. Verse 10. To another, the working of miracles. What's a miracle? Something happening in the natural world that supersedes what can normally happen. Right? It's a manifestation of something beyond the normal. A healing is a miracle. Someone jumping out of a wheelchair is a miracle.
Right.
Someone even being born again just in a snap of fingers.
Amen.
That's right.
It's a supernatural energizing of God's miracle working power because he's a miracle working God.
That's right.
The sun stood still. It was a miracle. When the man of God said, "Sun, be still till I defeat these enemies." The whole calendar was changed by that. The sun, the dial went back on the dial of Ahaz for Hezekiah, 10 degrees. That's a miracle. God intervened in the natural events of life. Yes?
You know, that's what I was going to say. You know, we think miracles are just cancer's falling off, and they are.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, a miracle is any time that heaven changes earth.
Oh, yes.
That's
it's
right.
It's an intervention from God. And
right.
It could be as simple as someone praying a sinner's prayer with you. That's a miracle.
Amen.
Someone could be born again.
That's right.
Spirit.
Right.
Nicodemus didn't even understand it.
Right.
How can these things be?
Right.
A man can be born again that's been born already into this world. That is a miracle of God.
Amen.
That
Amen.
That is a miracle of
Amen.
God when that happens. When that happened to me, that was a flat-out miracle that a complete drug addict
right.
could be instantaneously, with the snap of a finger, no longer addicted to drugs. No, you know, addiction recovery program, no 12-step program.
Right.
One step to Jesus, one snap of a
woo!
Finger. That is a flat-out miracle.
That's right, man. That's right.
That's a miracle of deliverance. And that
Come
can happen
on.
For anybody.
Yeah.
That can happen right here, right now. It's
oh, man.
To us. Doesn't that excite you, sister?
You know, Brother Ken, I remember I volunteered a couple nights a week at a rescue homeless mission before we moved up to pastor 20 years ago. And it was, all the volunteers were from different denominations, so you had a different theological mix. And mm-hmm. we were talking about drugs and stuff like that, and I said something that I had. He made the comment, because I said I had been delivered from cocaine, and he made the comment about, well, once an addict, always an addict, and I said, that's a lie. I didn't walk away from it. I was delivered from it.
Amen.
I would
not
be an
that's
addict.
Right.
Amen. They don't really like all those 12-step programs.
That,
they hate it when I go to those programs, because I will not say I'm an alcoholic. I won't do it. I'm going to say, I'm delivered by the grace of God and Jesus Christ, and I'm standing here today to be a witness of it in this meeting.
Right.
They'll almost kick you out the door.
That's right.
You're supposed to come in here and confess. But there is much good done through 12-step program. I'm not bashing that.
Sure.
Right.
But I'm saying the miracle program is much quicker.
That's right. Right.
Hallelujah! Glory!
Yes.
It's all about the higher
Glory
power.
Glory to God. The most high God. Amen. Amen. A lot higher than all that power.
That's right.
That I did. To know that the working of miracles, to know the prophecy. There's that word prophecy again. Are you prophetic people today? Whew. Well, let me answer that. You are.
Come on.
I know you're looking at me wanting to know the answer. Say that with me. I am a prophetic person.
I am a prophetic person.
Yes. I will prophesy.
I will prophesy.
My sons and daughters will
My
prophesy.
My sons and daughters will prophesy.
My maidservants will prophesy.
My maidservants will prophesy.
Sure. Yes. My lawn care person
My
will
lawn
prophesy.
Care person will prophesy.
My goodness. We need to be prophesying in the church, and it's just speaking the word of God. It's nothing magical, mysterious. Although you can read people's mail.
I don't want to keep. But Pastor Johnny was sharing. I mentioned how touched I was by the Jesus Culture Conference, and he mentioned the impact that their church is having in their community out there. That you know, you can go to a 7-Eleven out there, and the store clerk will prophesy over you.
Amen.
That doesn't happen by accident.
No.
It doesn't happen by osmosis. It happens because you get a group of people charged by the Holy Spirit, and they go out and they take it to the streets and they take it to the community. So every time that we go over there, we have an opportunity to witness. Pastor Scott shares oftentimes about how his son-in-law was working over there one time, and we had somebody that was flying the patch, you know, walked over there and was all full of themselves and made a fool of themselves and didn't know that that was Pastor Scott's son-in-law. And, you know, it came out. But we have the opportunity to salt our community in such a way that, guess what? We can make it so that that guy is prophesying over people that come in
Amen.
There. And the people over at CVS when we go over there and say, how you doing,
That's
Christine?
Right.
So remember their names, where everybody knows your name. I wasn't here last week, but man, it's all about that. You know, show that love and be able to get people to want to do those things.
Now, there's a key word in that, culture. They're called Jesus culture.
Culture. That's
a culture is something that's been environmentalized, localized,
that's good.
And ingrown into some people
mm-hmm.
through the Holy Spirit. There's a culture in this church of the gifts of the Spirit that's been preached and taught in the kingdom of God. There's a culture growing in this church of a kingdom consciousness and a miracle consciousness and a salvation consciousness, as opposed to the works of the flesh in Galatians 5 are these.
Mm-hmm.
Drunkenness.
Right.
Debauchery.
Sure.
You know, all that stuff.
Right.
But we're developing a culture of righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
And I love the way Kenneth Copeland says it. We need to have a righteousness consciousness instead of a sin.
That's right.
Mm. We need to develop a culture of miracles.
Right.
To where, like you say, so Jesus' culture, they have cultivated something that
mm-hmm.
has gone beyond just one guy teaching at a point. It's become a whole movement.
Right.
So Amen. A culture in society is a powerful thing. And so as you continue to gather here and continue to feed on these things and get on YouTube and look at all these teachings that have come out, you know, and look what the pastor's saying and put it all together. God has been speaking for 4 months to this church. And I don't know. I know he spoke 8 months before we got here. But I'm telling you, in the past 4 months, I look back on some of those and I was just like, God is speaking to his church.
Amen.
Amen.
I mean, if you get a hold of 10% of what's been said in here, you're going to come out with fire and gunpowder coming out your ears, man. I'm telling you.
Come
you
on.
Guys, or you know, God has a high calling.
That's right.
He wouldn't have invested this much energy into this. I wouldn't be up to 1:30. You know, you don't understand how many hours, my wife can tell you, I'm on the computer researching different theological viewpoints before I bring it to you. And there's good stuff out there, but I filter through it all, and God helps me to bring you something that I know is going to build the church at Crossroads Chapel.
Right.
To make a culture in this church. I love that. Jesus culture. What a powerful name.
Amen.
What an explicit meaning in that name. Verse 10, working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kind of tongues, and to another interpretation of tongues. There's the nine, and I'm just going to briefly look at each one. The first one is the word of knowledge, and it goes closely with the word of wisdom because it kind of works together. There are three revelation gifts, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discernment. These three really work together closely. Those are called revelation gifts. Easy to kind of categorize these. There are three power gifts, faith, miracles, and healing. They kind of go together. They seem to kind of work together. There's three vocal gifts, prophecy, tongues, and interpretation. It's kind of interesting that that makes your nine. Two of these gifts are only new from the day of Pentecost. And you might guess what those two are, tongues and interpretation. And there's so much misunderstanding in the Bible. I wish I had an hour just to go on that again, but I don't.
Amen.
But all of the other seven were in the Old Testament, throughout the Old Testament. There are only two new ones from the day of Pentecost because Jesus had not risen and given that gift to the church to undo, basically, Babylon and Babel, Tower of Babel, which we don't have time for that either, but was tongues and interpretation, heavenly language. But the first one is word of knowledge. What is it? That's a small piece of information from God downloaded into your mind that you couldn't have known except God told you, that you knew about this brother right here. There's no way you knew it naturally. God gave it. It came from the Holy Spirit. God told you something. Now, what are you supposed to do with that knowledge? Unless you have a word of wisdom to go with that from God, now take that knowledge and go pray for that brother and cast the devil out of him. I'm not looking at you. That's a word of wisdom. Amen. Because there's
move,
word
brother.
Of knowledge. You know something, but that word of wisdom is what to do with the knowledge you get. You see how the two tandemly work together?
Right.
Sometimes it's knowledge, like I give you Bible examples of this. The woman at the well in John 4:17, talking to Jesus, and Jesus had knowledge about her. She was married five times. You know, he knew all the stuff about her because he's Jesus, but he worked in prophecy. He was working prophetically at that well. And she began to say, I don't know, man. And he said, no, you have had five men, and the one you have now is not your husband. I perceive you're a prophet. Well, I don't think that took a whole lot for you. But then, what did Jesus do? He began to work with wisdom. He had knowledge, but then he worked with wisdom. He says, go. And she went and evangelized the whole village of Samaritans and saying, come see a man that told me everything I ever did. Because the gift of prophecy was working.
Right.
What about you? Can it happen with you at 7-Eleven? And you just walk up and God just downloads you with a little fact about that guy over there. I can't think of his name. He'll be embarrassed if he sees this on YouTube. And if he gets saved, which he probably will, he'll probably see it one day.
Amen.
I can't think of his name, but I know Amy's been working on him. I've been working on him. And I get a little bit of information. He's a young man. He's Dylan. Oh, we're calling you out, Dylan, in Jesus' name. I know that's funny, but God's calling that man's name. And God will give me just a little snippet. It might be three words. But then if that's all I have, that's as far as I can. But if I get a word of knowledge, you know, and the Lord's also saying he wants to heal you of that sickness right now. And you can lay hands on right there. If God gives you the knowledge, you have the knowledge and the word of wisdom, what to do with the knowledge, a healing can take place. A deliverance can take place. If you don't get the word of wisdom, it's just for you to pray about or know the information or speak it out so that they'll believe. What about a waitress when you're going to do like Brother Dawson does? You want to play a game? Let's prophesy over the waitress when she comes to the table. I love doing that. Never did that with me at Cracker Barrel. It was powerful.
Right.
And God, give us a few things for this lady. Just practice these. Practice
these right.
things. Amen.
Holy Spirit has given you this knowledge and insight into something that you could not know. It's an inner witness. Sometimes it's a word picture. Sometimes it's just a dream or a thought, a day vision. But God has given you knowledge about it. That you could not have known short of the Holy Spirit putting it there for a purpose. Deborah?
You know, the thing about the word of wisdom that kind of sets it apart is it's more future tense. The word of knowledge most of the time is a present, what's going on now. And the word of wisdom is ahead.
Well, what to do with that? But a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge could be something in a person's past. It could be so many different things that we'd have to sit here and conjecture all day. But it's information from the Holy Ghost downloaded to you because you're a vessel, right? Because you've got Jesus in you. This could happen to any of you in this room. Don't think it could. Don't look at me that way, sister. You, yes, God's calling your name. Yes, amen. I won't say your name out loud. Amen. Word of wisdom. Noah and the ark. Think about that. Noah's out there building an ark. He had knowledge from God that there's going to be a flood come. That was the knowledge. A flood is going to come. A flood is going to come. Noah's standing there. Cool. It's never rained. A flood's going to come. He believed God. He didn't. But then what was the word of wisdom? Go build an ark. See how that word of knowledge, word of wisdom worked together? It took 120 years to build an ark. Think about that. That's just one little small story. To apply the knowledge given, to know what to do. How to complete an assignment, that's wisdom. How to handle a crisis in life, that takes wisdom. How do I handle this crisis? You need a word of wisdom. Should I get another job? Should I move? You know, how should I speak this to this person? Should I not speak this? Should I go meet this person? Should, when I go do this estimate, should I go to this door and do this? Should I walk around? Wisdom, wisdom, wisdom. My goodness, we need wisdom. Because I don't know how to do stuff. I depend on God to show me how to do things.
That's right.
The third one's prophecy. Oh my gosh. We've talked so much about prophecy. Look at what 1 Corinthians 14:1 says. It says, brethren, desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Paul is saying, especially covet to prophesy in the church. Why? Because the church can be built up. He didn't say prophet, he didn't say covet to speak in tongues. He said, do not forbid to speak in tongues, but he said, covet. That my church may be built up. Amen. If you do speak in tongues privately, that's to build you up. Jude, verse 20. To build you up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. That's to build you up. We got ahead on tongues on that one. A word, a message to be given to someone, to edify, to build up. Many times prophecy confirms what you already know. You get a prophetic word from somebody, and the deep brain within you goes, yeah, I knew that. I just needed someone to confirm, to tell me I was on track. I was doing I knew that 5 years ago. I knew that. See, prophetic word builds you up. It gives you confidence to go forward. It predicts future events. It confirms, it instructs. Prophecies can be tested. They always line up with Scripture. Always. You can't walk up to somebody and say, God told you to marry me and we're going to get engaged tomorrow. It lines up with Scripture. You can't be presumptuous. And see, you can hurt people with these gifts. If you have no character, you can go out and hurt somebody. How many ministers have I heard of that went up to some woman because she was beautiful in his eyes? And he said, God said we're supposed to be married. And then they got married and it wasn't of God, and then it fell apart because they had no character. They had no foundation. They might have had a prophetic gift, but then they just coveted. And the flesh overcame, and the character was not there, and then they went and used a gift from God, and they basically prostituted the gift from God. That's happened so many times, I can tell you. Just get on the internet and look, it's happened so many times in the church. I'm talking about in the church. Goodness. Test prophecies. Make sure they line up with the Word of God. Faith is the fourth one. Think about the centurion that came to Jesus, and he needed healing for one of his servants. And he said, Jesus said, what do you need? And one of my servants needs to be healed. You don't need to go into the world. Just speak the word and it'll be done. And what did Jesus say? So great a faith I've not seen in all Israel. He was gifted with a measure of a great gift of faith because he understood authority. He said, you just speak the word. And he went home and he said, from that very hour, the servant said, amen. That's a gift of faith. When you can pray in $1 million, that's a gift of faith. When you can go out and do extraordinary things for God in the power of the Spirit, that's a gift of faith. When you can start a men's group, brother, and know that there's going to be continual outpour of the Holy Spirit like this Tuesday night, that's a gift of faith to go forward and do something. It's a gift of faith. It takes faith to be saved, right? That's how we come into this thing. Everything in the kingdom is apprehended by faith. That's a measure of faith, but a gift of faith. You know, you can touch someone with a minor ailment and say, be healed in Jesus' name. You can feel heat go through your hands. That's faith. But it takes a greater gift of faith to walk up to a paraplegic in a wheelchair. And you heard the word for a word of wisdom say, go lay hands on that person in that wheelchair, even though your mind's saying, I've never done this before. What if they don't get up? But you do it, you obey God, and they get up out of the wheelchair. That's supernatural faith. See, you see the difference in level, echelons of faith? Amen. Jesus went to certain villages. He said he could only heal a few sick folk because their unbelief was so great. He could only heal a few sick folk of just a cold or something like that. But he could have come in and put hands back on people and ears back on people and done all kinds of stuff. But their faith was so weak that he could do only minor miracles. Yeah, a miracle's a miracle. It's a good thing. Minor miracles. Wow. Are you getting something out of this?
Amen.
Shoot. Boldness and strength and courage to accomplish greater things for God takes faith. Boldness takes faith. Amen. Right. Walking. Oh, Deborah. Remember the Mexico missions trip. Deborah stumbled. We're walking up this cliff. I heard her back crack. I heard this. And I go, oh my God, what was that? It was her back. She went down to the ground. I'm with two guys that speak two versions of Mexican and Spanish, and I'm speaking English. We had to literally pick her up off the ground. There's no medevac. We're 10,000 miles from nowhere, 10,000 feet in the mountains. We don't even know where we're at. It's a place called the Place of the Water. It's a Mayan village up in the mountains. And we pick her up, and we start praying, speaking in tongues, and just doing, we just started trying to get something going, you know. Picked her up and walked her out of that mountain by a miracle of faith. She was able to cast off the fear because she heard it too, and she felt it. Grabbed her both sides, walked up out of that mountain. Healed.
Amen.
We didn't even pray for healing. We just started speaking in tongues. There's no doctors, there's no medevac, there's nothing going to happen. If she doesn't get up right now, we're going to be sitting here on this mountain and we won't be able to get her back.
No cell phones either.
No cell phones. I'm talking about in situations like that, you find out the faith that's available to you to operate in.
Right.
That was faith and that was a working of miracles, which is the next one. That was a miracle intervention of God. An intervention in the natural universe by God. That's a miracle. A phenomenon that transcends natural law. A divine act by which God reveals himself to people. In a miracle. God reveals himself in an auto accident when somebody comes out and escaped when they should have died. And he reveals himself. That's a miracle. An angel came and protected that person and wrapped them up and didn't let them get hurt. Even though they went through the windshield and hit a phone pole. It's a miracle. That's a miracle. Amen. You're a miracle. You are a walking miracle. Wow. An example is healing, casting out of demons, a miracle. Water turned into wine. We're going to sing that song this morning. That's a miracle.
Amen.
He said, get that thing and fill it with water. He turned it into wine. That's a miracle. Amen. The Red Sea was parted. You remember that? God saying to Moses, why are you crying unto me? Stretch out your staff. All Moses knew to do is cry out. God, the Egyptians are coming. He said, why are you crying out to me? Lift up your staff. As soon as he obeyed God. You understand? That's a miracle. That's a miracle. He knew, but God gave him a little piece of information. Lift up your staff. That takes faith to lift up your staff. Amen. You right. See the Egyptians coming at you. It takes faith to do that. Johnny?
Yeah. We went to the part of the worship team went to the evangelism and worship conference up in Atlanta that was the Jesus Culture. Was there, and they put it on. It was a 3-day event. And the hotel that we were staying at was full of mainly youth groups, worship teams, stuff like that. And so you're walking through this hotel, and it's full of worship. They're sitting in the lobby on the floor singing, oh, how he loves us. And just, all this, that was the atmosphere that was there. We came back one day, and what had happened in the pool was somebody that wasn't there, and they were just there at the hotel. They weren't there as a part of the Jesus Culture thing. This kid falls into the pool and drowns. Okay, so they start pulling him out, and the paramedics are called. They're going and starting to do stuff. Well, this one teenage girl, God spoke to her and said, because one of the things they talked about was not letting things happen on your watch. It's your watch. So you stand up and say, not on my watch. So this girl stood up and said, not on my watch. She walked out to the pool. lay hands on this kid, the kid starts coughing, spitting up the water, and everything else, right there, and all the people stand, and they just went, wow, this, you know, and it was a miracle.
It was a miracle of God.
Right there, visibly, you know.
So that people would believe, because that's why miracles happen. Number seven is discerning of spirits. You know, what kind of discernment do you need? Is it the Holy Spirit speaking? Is it a demonic spirit speaking? Is it a human spirit? Somebody in their woundedness speaking? You know, is it an angel? There's like four definitions of discernment. You need the gift of discernment tells you what's operating in a given situation. If you feel uncomfortable and you say, oh, that's a human spirit or that person. That's discernment. I mean, it could be foaming at the mouth, okay? It could be epilepsy, which is a sickness, which is from the devil. Or it could be a demon spirit working. We need discernment. How many times could it save you from terrible mistakes and consequences? Discerning of spirits. I wish I had time to go an hour on that one. Wow. In the last year, were tongues and interpretation of tongues, and we don't even have time to go there. Have you guys enjoyed these series we've had here?
Amen.
Woo! I want you to say this with me. I am a gift.
I am a gift.
I possess a gift.
I possess a gift.
Holy Spirit lives in me.
Holy Spirit lives in me.
And He manifests through me.
And He manifests through me.
Any way He wants to.
Any way He wants to.
I have character.
I have character.
I will operate in the fruit of the Spirit.
I will operate in the fruit of the Spirit.
And I will manifest all nine flavors of the Spirit.
And I will manifest all nine flavors of the Spirit.
I'm a willing vessel, Lord.
I'm a willing vessel, Lord.
I lift up my hands.
I lift up my hands.
I surrender to you.
I surrender to you.
Fill me to overflow.
Fill me to overflow.
Flow through me.
Flow through me.
And encourage my brothers.
Encourage my brothers.
And I give you all the praise.
I give you all the praise.
In Jesus' mighty name.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.